So I am thrilled that you had this much patience, Peg, and delighted to be here. I was in the Peace Corps in Bulgaria in the mid-1990s, and I wrote a collection of short stories set in the small mountain village where I lived and taught English. And I have now been working on a novel about a Bulgarian family that comes to the United States. And I'm going to read to you from the novel tonight. And it's the passage that I'm going to read. The family decides, so the book kind of toggles back and forth between America and a Bulgarian village where there's a grandmother who's been left behind. And the family decides to send the grandmother $2,000 just so she has it. And this kind of really creates a problem for the grandmother, who kind of finds out about it before winter, and then the bus stops running, and when the bus starts up again, she finally decides to do something about it. Donka Dimitrova's decision to take the bus that day was without anticipation, and yet it seemed this had somehow always been the plan. She simply put on her shoes. "Ciao, Ilche," she said to the little white goat when she felt the rumble in the road. She didn't have time to do the morning milking. It was Ilka's turn to wait. When the bus appeared around the bend, she waved to it, and it stopped for her. The step was high, her belly pressed against her thigh as she used the handles to hoist herself up. "Do et pele," she huffed. "Kolkoe." She had no idea how much the bus cost these days. She took a seat a few rows back next to the window on the sunny side of the bus. Cool early morning air seeped in around the window casing and worried through the fibers of her coat. Donka's heart pounded. When had she last felt so alive? The cushion beneath her was worn and springy, and she felt jaunty as she bounced along the rugged mountain road. She gripped the seat in front of her to steady herself and felt a tickle rising inside. The spring poking into her bottom, the spirited gypsy tunes. There was a whole wide world out there, and in this moment, she was a part of it. Her patch of earth, just one tiny square in this quilted countryside, so wrinkled it made for the bumpiest of rides. Oh, she hadn't had this much fun in a long time. A few stray tears jostled loose from the corners of her eyes. Zhivko, who was her deceased husband, as a rule, didn't like buses, and he had never liked to be away from the garden, even for a day, making it impossible for Donka to enjoy even modest adventures. Now, as the bus carried her away from her unkempt garden, happiness spread through her. "This is not so bad, Jivko," she thought. "This is all right." The bank did not have the $2,000 at this time. The young man behind the counter said this with no note of apology or regret. "You'll have to come back tomorrow," he said. "I need the money today," she said. Already she could feel stiffness settling into her joints. Standing with her feet rooted to the floor, she understood she would ride this bus only one more time in her life, and that would be her return trip home. "That will not be possible," he said. "The truck from Sofia has already come. It will come again tomorrow." This was exactly what she had feared, that the money wouldn't be there. Money was unreliable. Donka had known for decades that a life savings could vanish overnight, and that the only thing you could count on was the ground beneath your feet. Luba, her daughter, appeared to have forgotten this when she'd sent the $2,000 through the air. "You shouldn't have waited until the last minute," the young man said. The man was right. She had waited too long. She knew if she came back tomorrow or the next day or the day after that, the money wouldn't be there. This young man with his plain face and blank expression had been specially trained in withholding people's money. "I will wait," she said. "There's no point in waiting," he said. "There is no other option," she said. "Will you bring me a chair?" The man looked at her. He couldn't take his morning coffee with the old lady there. If he gave her a chair, he could be stuck with her for a long time. "That would be against bank policy," he said. "Can you please step aside?" "I'm not finished," Donka said. She drummed her fingers on the counter. Behind her, another customer was getting impatient. "How can the bank have a policy against chairs?" "The bank doesn't want customers to loiter," the young man said, looking unsettled. wasn't used to customers ganging up on him. Donka didn't budge. The $2,000 or lack thereof was starting to make her feel powerful. "Where are your manners?" the man behind Donka said. "Give the grandmother a chair." The young man looked unhappy. Donka thought of her own grandson who would look just as unhappy if he were stuck in a bank all day. Eventually, the young man got up and disappeared, then came back with a flimsy plastic cafe chair, which he placed in a corner of the small bank vestibule. When Donka lowered herself into it, the chair leg scraped on the floor. She did not say thank you. Since she would never return to AAA, she could think of many ways to spend her money before she went back home. She would like to go to the cafeteria and have a bowl of the thin soup. She would like to buy herself a new pair of slippers from the market at the bus station. She would like to buy some hair dye. Several boxes, she decided, in a rainbow of colors. She would like to buy a souvenir for Ilka, but she couldn't think of one thing the goat might need. Instead, she decided she would buy herself a toasted sandwich and tell Ilka about it. By noon, Donka was wondering if the young man had forgotten about her. She got up from the chair, making a point of scraping the legs on the floor. She was so stiff, she could barely move. The young man looked bored. "I'm still waiting," she said. "I know," said the man. "Why don't you get some lunch?" "I will get some lunch when I have my $2,000," she said. The young man shrugged. "You might get hungry," he said. At 2 o'clock, the young man approached Donka's chair. "Nothing is going to change," he said. "You'll have to make other arrangements." Donka blinked several times. As the minutes ticked by, she decided she didn't need the soup. She could forgo the sandwich and possibly coffee too, but she would like the slippers and the hair dye. The hair dye, she decided, she would like very much. Donka looked up at the young man. The afternoon sun filtered in through the bank's dirty windows, illuminating a constellation of dust particles that floated around his head and landed in his hair. Seeing this, Donka felt queasy and hot, and she wondered what the young man would look like with blue hair or green hair or purple hair instead of his drab and dusty shade of brown. She unbuttoned her coat to get some air, but it was hard to breathe with all the dust. Her lungs were probably filled with particles. "Babo?" "Yes." "Babo, what's happening?" Donka didn't know what was happening. She had murky lungs and no money and a bus she was almost certain to miss. She needed to go to the bathroom, but she didn't know if she could stand up, which was confusing, seeing she had been sitting and standing all her life. Was that what it felt like at the end? If Zhivko was here, she would have asked him that. Zhivko had been terribly confused in his final months. "Babo?" the young man asked. He looked nervous. "Do you have a grandmother?" she asked. "Yes," he said, "in the village." "Does she ride the bus?" "All the time," he said. "Then she's not as old as I am," Donka said. "If I leave without the money, I will die," she said, which was such a ridiculous thing to say, she nearly snorted. Even on The Bold and the Beautiful, where life and death were called into question on a daily basis, people didn't die over $2,000. The young man didn't know what to make of this. "What do you mean you will die?" "Exactly that," she said. Over the course of this long day, her sense of her own mortality had drawn ever closer. She might die at any moment. "You're lucky I haven't died already." The young man looked at her. "You don't look like you're going to die," he said. You're nice and plump." "Even plump people die," Donka said. "What if we can get you $1,000, the young man asked. It was 3 o'clock now, and he'd been talking on his phone. "I'm not getting out of this chair for less than $2,000, she said. At this point, she was so stiff, she wasn't sure she could get out of the chair. "I knew the chair was a mistake," he said. Donka agreed. This whole thing was a mistake. The $2,000, the bus ride, everything. "The bus leaves at 4:30, Donka said. "I will miss it." "Where will you stay?" the young man said. "I'll stay right here," she said. "You can't stay here," he said. "The bank will close." "The bank will close with me in it," she said. She wondered if there was a bathroom inside the bank. She hoped there was. She might not need hair dye or the slippers, but she did need a bathroom. The young man looked unhappy. He couldn't close the bank with a customer inside, not even one stuck in the chair, and he wasn't going to stay at the bank all night. "This is serious," he said. "I've been trying to tell you that all day," said Donko.